Welcome back to Reviews with Elaine, because I have opinions. Today I have opinions about All the Weyrs of Pern by Anne McCaffrey. There is a lot to address before I even get to the book in this review. This book has been on my to-be-read shelf for longer than any book ever has. We're talking about nigh on 20 years here. I have a really complicated relationship with the Pern books. They were my absolute favorite when I was a child. Like, through late elementary, middle school, and into junior high, they were the books that I read, reread, daydreamed about. Every time I went to a bookstore, I was looking for another Pern book. They were my obsession. And my favorite character was the Master Harper, Robinton. Like, honestly, up until 8th grade, if you had asked me who was my favorite character in all of fiction, I would have named him without a second thought. Like, he was the only person on the list to me. And then I got to the point in the series where he dies. Or where I thought he died. And I couldn't read any further. Like, literally, I put down the book mid-chapter and never picked up a single Pern book that took place chronologically after that. Now, I did go back and reread some of the others, but I never read any further. And eventually, I stopped reading them. For about 2 decades, I didn't pick up a single Pern book. Until about 2 years ago, I finally went back to finish The White Dragon. And I didn't like it. And not because Robinton died, because, spoiler alert, turns out he doesn't die in that book. But just because I didn't like the book. It felt a bit directionless. It felt more like a memoir than a traditional novel, and I'm not a huge fan of memoir. There was a lot less fluid arc and more just like random shit that happened in Jackson's life. It also felt incredibly dated, like with so much gendered stereotyping, and there was a really simplistic view of good characters versus bad characters. And going back the series, I even found some things that I did not like about Robinton. But about a year later, I finally read the next in the series, The Renegades of Pern. And it was worse. Like, a lot worse. It felt like Anne McCaffrey had no idea what was the important parts of her own book. Like, scenes that could have been fully drawn out were just skimmed over. And scenes that really should have been skimmed over or left out entirely were fully drawn out with minute detail filling pages. And characters felt even more flat than they had in the previous two books. I wondered if I had maybe just outgrown Anne McCaffrey, and I mourned the love that I'd had for that series as a child. It felt like I had literally lost part of my childhood. Then I went back and reread the Harper trilogy mainly just to reassure myself, and Dragon Drums, Dragon Song, and Dragon Singer were still lovely books. Now, they are young adult books versus most of Pern, which is an adult series, but they're good books. They're enjoyable. And I realized that it really was just those last two books weren't great. So All the Weyrs of Pern got set aside again, because I was afraid that I was going to read another one that just wasn't up to snuff, and I just couldn't bring myself to do it. I actually considered pulling up the synopsis of the series of Pern online just so I can finally figure out what happened without having to actually read the damn book. But about a week ago, I finally picked up this book, literally thinking the thoughts, let's get this over with. And when I sat down to read it, I will admit, I sat down to read it with a focus on figuring out what was wrong with it. And in the beginning, I found the problems I expected to. The characters felt flat, the story felt misshapen, and everything felt like it had been written in the 1970s, when the earliest Pern books were written. Yet slowly, despite all its flaws, I found myself falling back into the series that I had loved as a child. So All the Weyrs of Pern is the book where Pern turns back from a fantasy series into a sci-fi series. Like, yeah, there are snippets in the earlier books that like, oh look, hint, hint, this is still sci-fi, but no, they're fantasy. But this book is sci-fi. In the last book, Jackson, Pymer, and Janice had rediscovered Landing, the original site where the colonists established their first settlement on Pern. And more importantly, they had rediscovered Avis, the AI that had been left behind in a computer in Landing. And in the last 2,500 years, it seems Avis has still been working on the last project it was assigned to discover a way to completely eradicate Thread from Pern. Wait. You need to know a lot more about this series for any of those words to make sense. So, Pern is a series set on a far, far distant planet in the far, far distant future. There was a war of some sort in the main part of the universe. There were aliens involved somehow. Honestly, I do not remember the details here. I have not read Dragon's Dawn in 20 years. And also, if memory serves, McCaffrey's not super explicit in Dragon's Dawn as to what actually happened before the series starts. But what we know is there are a group of colonists who gather together, sign on to an expedition to settle this really distant planet, Pern. They go with the full knowledge that there will be no coming back. There is not enough fuel to get them back. But also, there's gonna be no rescue. They do have distress signals, but it's gonna take like a decade for the distress signals to get back to the main part of the occupied universe, and probably a couple of decades for people to come out and find them to help them. So they really are on their own. They also know they're going to be living a much more agrarian lifestyle, but objectively that's sort of the point. These people are disillusioned with modern society and the war that came from it, so they're looking for a more simplistic, more, like, primitive life. And when they first land on Pern, it seems that everything is going the way they want. They build settlements, they build a culture and government, they start having kids, they're living a great life. Until about 7 years after the colonists land. Suddenly, this weird gray stuff starts falling from the sky. They will eventually discover it is an organism, and they call it Thread. But Thread can eat through anything organic, including humans. This is a truly existential crisis for the colonists, because this stuff is killing people, it's destroying buildings, destroying crops, destroying livestock. And it won't stop growing until it's killed by either fire or drowning. So, of course, the colonists fight back. And originally they do fight back with the tech they brought with them, like they use planes to basically flamethrow the stuff out of the sky. They actually use the space shuttles to go up into space to see if they can shoot it out of the sky, the orbit of Pern, but nothing's working. This stuff is still falling from the sky, like, once a week, and basically being a rainstorm that kills swaths of land. And so yeah, this is a serious threat to the colony. But they have one hope here. When they first landed on Pern, they discovered an indigenous species to this planet that they named fire lizards. They're basically miniature dragons, like, you know, cat size. They can sit on your shoulder, and they can fly, they can teleport, they are mildly telepathic, they can breathe fire, and they seem to instinctively fight Thread. Basically, it's implied that they probably evolved to fight this stuff. And so the colonists decide to use these creatures as basically a blueprint to create a species specifically designed to protect them from Thread. The dragons. They make them big enough for a human to ride, significantly more intelligent, and most importantly, they make them form permanent bonds with humans. So there's one human to one dragon, and these humans will be the Dragon Riders. So that's all in Dragon's Dawn. The majority of the series actually takes place 2,500 years down the line. Pern has evolved into this pseudo-feudal agrarian society. Dragons protect the skies of Pern, and Dragon Riders are mostly really respected people. But also, Pern is this weirdly peaceful society. Like, just as a world-building situation, what McCaffrey's created here is very interesting. Because, like, one of the big events that launches the original series of the Pern books is there's one lord holder, which is Pern words for basically a feudal lord, who is the first one ever to try to conquer neighboring holds, so neighboring lands. And so that basically means there has been one war, and it's a pretty minor war, in the last 2,500 years. Now, there's a lot of problems with Pern. There's a lot of misogyny, there's classism, there's inequality, and just basic human evils, but nothing really compared to what we see on Earth in the actual feudal era, which is just interesting. But Pern has, up until Jackson's discovery of Avis, completely forgotten that they are a colony planet. They have lost pretty much all tech in more advanced than, like, medieval. They have forgotten they even created the dragons in the first place. But there have always been some people who dreamed of getting rid of Thread permanently. And in the main series, the main character that pushes for a complete elimination of Thread is Flar, one of our major Dragon Rider characters. Now we jump back to this book. Avis, the AI, almost as soon as it's discovered, first it tells everyone the backstory of the entirety of Pern, and then it explains that it has been working on this problem all along. And it seems, somewhere in the last 2,500 years, Avis figured out how to get rid of Thread. But to do so, all of Pern is going to have to take a giant leap forward in pretty much every field of science and technology. In the desperate attempt to get them ready to, in about 4 years, send dragons into space. Which is part of the reason this book is so fucking fun, conceptually. We basically have a book about medieval people getting to jump suddenly into the future. And dragons in space. I cannot emphasize to you how fun it is for someone like me to read a book about dragons in space. But that's also some of the problem with this book. Like in Renegades, McCaffrey doesn't seem to know which are the important parts for the book and which aren't. Their story could have been really heavily streamlined, and dozens of scenes of characters learning advanced science could have been just summarized. And there are so many meetings. Like, Anne McCaffrey, God bless her, loved to write a good meeting. And I know it's not just the Pern series. Her other series also feature an absurdly large amount of meetings. But generally across the board, that means that there are buttloads of scenes of discussions and lectures. Though I sort of get why she left them in, because I'm not entirely sure there's enough of a book in this book without the scenes of complex science classes and explanations. And I think McCaffrey was aware of that problem. There's this weird repeated thread, pun fully intended there, of moments throughout the entire book where a POV character will be wondering what Avis's full plan is and wondering why the hell Avis won't tell them the full plan. Because no, the AI will not tell the people in this series, in this book, what the actual plan is until pretty much they're full forward in it. And I'm not sure it exactly makes sense for the AI to be refusing to tell them the entire plan. And McCaffrey puts a band-aid on this by having Avis explain to the people of Pern that they're just not ready to hear the plan yet. It's too scientifically advanced, and they won't believe it is possible until they've learned all the science behind each step. But this feels like McCaffrey is trying desperately to find an excuse to not just tell us the entire plot in the first 20 pages of the book. And what it ends up doing is making Avis seem really patronizing and paternalistic to a downright absurd degree. Avis is an interesting character. McCaffrey wrote him as very human. And that brings up questions of motives, likes, dislikes, even gender. Like, there is actually a discussion in the book about should we call Avis it or he. And this occasionally makes for an interesting tension of, like, do we trust this AI? Though, knowing Anne McCaffrey's writing, the question had no tension to me, personally, because I know she was an intensely optimistic author. Of course the AI was there for the greater good. It's Anne McCaffrey. But this weirdly brings me to the next problem. McCaffrey tried really hard to create a believable opposition to Avis in this book. She sets a crew of characters as the ones who distrust Avis, who do not want Pern to rediscover lost technology, and who think of the AI as an abomination. And I really think this should have worked. Like, objectively, those people exist, but I don't buy it the way McCaffrey wrote it. It feels like she didn't find these people's real arguments and thought processes until near the end of the book. for the first three quarters, it just feels like they are calling Avis an abomination because the story needed somebody to call Avis an abomination. And I think the problem was we don't really see any fear in them. Like, people who reject advanced tech usually do so out of fear. And these characters just seem flatly angry and irrational. And I think it's just because McCaffrey herself couldn't wrap her mind around this character's way of thinking. But I also think, by this point in the series, McCaffrey had far too many characters, all of whom she loved way too deeply. Which creates this chaos for the reader when we spend pages and pages and pages reading about what each and every person is doing. We don't need to know what all these characters are doing throughout the book. But we do. In every meeting, we have to see them all featured and they all have to speak their minds. And there are way too many scenes of characters thinking about how much they love their friends. And I mean, I grew up with these characters. I love them too. But we don't need all of them in every scene. And one thing across the board that just drives me nuts about the later Pern books is how many perfectly happy heteronormative couples there are just being happy. Like, I love the fact that McCaffrey never gave in to the temptation to just build drama with petty lovers' quarrels. But every character has a partner who is just so good for them. And, like, it's literally that phrase, so good for them, that is used so much. Like, T'Gallen is so good for Miriam. Shara has been so good for Jaxum. Pimer is so good for Janice. Sebel is so good for Minnelli. The only major character that does not have a partner that's constantly referenced in this book is Robinton. And everyone loves Robinton. Like, it gets irrational how many people love Robinton. Like, I know I loved him, but the entire planet of Pern loves the man. Like, literally, he is threatened as a desperate attempt to blackmail people into destroying Avis. Everyone agrees that this is a really brilliant plan because Pern would have been willing to give up their only chance to destroy this existential crisis just in a desperate attempt to save Robinton. So way back in Dragonflight and Dragon Quest, the original two books in the series, there were people who found Robinton annoying, meddlesome, and difficult. And now he's the planet's beloved grandfather that they'll do anything to save. And he has spent the majority of the past few books being a mediator. And fun fact, not everybody loves the mediator. So this does not feel entirely natural. But one of the things I find really annoying about the abundance of happy couples in Pern is I feel that many of the strong female characters that McCaffrey created in the early part of the series are softened by partnering up. They almost all suddenly act more pliant and kind and maternal as soon as they find a partner. And yes, almost all of them become mothers almost immediately. Because it seems everyone on Pern has kids when they're like 20 years old. And I'm not entirely sure McCaffrey always did the math on these babies. Because, like, I'm pretty sure Minnelli did not have kids when Landing was discovered, yet a couple of months down the line, she has three? And they are not triplets? But all that is a side note to the fact that it's just so incredibly heteronormative. And, like, that's fine. Books can be heteronormative. I don't mind that. But one of the things I loved about this series as a teenager was the fact that it wasn't. There were girls who pushed back against their assigned gender roles. These were some of the first books I ever read that actually featured queer characters. And yeah, they were always small, minor characters, and often a bit questionably stereotyped, but these books were written in the 1970s! Yet the ones that were written in the 90s suddenly are full of women happy to be healers and caregivers, improved by their men. And the references to the fact that the Green Dragon Riders tended to be queer just disappear. Nobody mentions it anymore. This all starts to make the books that were written in the 90s feel more like they were written in the 70s than the ones actually written in the 70s. But I am still happy to have read this book. I enjoyed it while reading it. I read the last 100 pages in one sitting just because I didn't want to put it down. And I feel a sense of completion having read it. This is technically not the end of the series. There's still Skies of Pern and Dolphins of Pern at least after this, plus all the stuff that Todd McCaffrey wrote that I never got to. And I even already own Dolphins of Pern, but this book finishes the quest that Lessa started when she impressed Rameth back in 1968. Spoiler alert, Robinton does die in this book. And for me, it feels like that is the end of the series. I think the reason Anne McCaffrey went so over the top with having everyone love Robinton in this book was because she was already mourning him. She made her world mourn with her. And yeah, I mourn too. If I'd read this book as a teenager when I first bought it, it would have wrecked me. But now that I'm older, it's hard for me not to see the flaws in the world that I loved with a passion as a child. And all this makes me even more really, really, really want to see the TV show slash movie they talk about every couple of years. Like, literally, every couple of years there's something else that comes out about, like, oh, they're gonna make Pern into a TV series. And I really, really wish they would, because there's a lot of good in this series. But it sort of needs modern sensibilities and a good script doctor to polish the gem that is under some of the more prevalent flaws.